And we're just about to start with our next speaker, Ron from AppAnnie. Hi, Ron.
Hi, Igor.
How are you?
I'm doing great. Thank you so much for having me here today.
We are very excited to have you. What have you prepared for us today?
Well, we're going to go through a little bit about what AppAnnie does, but really talk about, you know, how do we go drive, you know, really the game economy and put that together really with monetization today and some of the trends that we're seeing at a macro level here at AppAnnie as well.
Oh, that's fantastic. So a quick question before we start. Where are you located?
I'm in San Francisco, actually, in the Bay Area.
Oh, that's amazing to know. How is the summer going for you?
You know, I think like for all of us, we're trying to enjoy the summer while still thinking about all the different things that are going on globally. So it's a little bit of mixed emotions, but I have a 2-year-old at home. So if you see him, you know, knocking in or streaming in, I'm going to apologize in advance, but it's been a handful here, but overall it's been great.
Oh, no worries. We are very used to cats, children and dogs interrupting the presentation. So it's generally fine. So over to you right now. Good luck with the presentation.
Thank you so much, Igor. Really appreciate it. Hello, everybody, and welcome. And thank you all so much for spending just a few moments of your time here with me today. Excited about some of the core areas that we're going to cover from us all here at AppAnnie. So let's go ahead and get started. So for all of you, my name is Ron Thomas. I'm the GM of our analytics product line here at AppAnnie, and excited to talk to you a little bit about what we do as an organization for those of you who are unaware, and also just share with you some of the learnings and observations that we've seen as we work today with some of the world's leading brand publishers as well. So a little bit about AppAnnie, just to orient the conversation. AppAnnie as a whole, we're in subscription as a service business, really focused historically on our market data offering. So everything around really third-party data. So what's happening from a mobile economy perspective globally, and then, you know, what insights can you really try to unpack and really uncover as you think about your mission-critical business decisions? And then over time, our customers have also shared, they said, hey, that's fantastic that we're really able to understand where the market is and how and where it's going, but how about our own data and how about our own publishers? And so as a result of that, last week, we've actually launched our first party offering into the global marketplace called AppAnnie Ascend. We're incredibly excited to talk a little bit about both our solutions today and some of the ways in which our customers are leveraging all of our products and services. It's important to note that, hey, both these data sets are quarantined, they're fully compliant, and of course, it's all fueled by data science, and we're a global company located in every single part of the world in terms of the major areas from Asia Pacific, you know, China, for example, all the way through parts of Europe, and then here headquartered in North America in San Francisco. So a little bit about our customers. Just want to start off by saying thank you to each and every single one of you. I saw some of our customers in terms of some of the speakers that are listed on the site. And so really want to start off by saying thank you to all of you. We're incredibly privileged to count you as our customers and our partners as we think about where we're going and really, quite frankly, where we are today and how we've got here. So we have over kind of 1,100 plus global enterprise customers, some of the world's leading brands, as you can kind of see here, from Activision, you know, Ubisoft, Electronic Arts, Jamcity, Zynga, Ludi as well, and a host of other companies, an incredible amount of people on our platform in terms of scale, and then obviously an incredible number of apps that are connected for us to be able to share and provide information. So really the preeminent digital performance standard as we think about it at a global level. So thank you again to all of our customers, and thank you again for spending some time with us today. So what are some of the trends that we wanted to cover off? I think that there's quite a few things, and I think we all realize that you know, consumer expectations continue to evolve, and the world we live in is changing all the time. And part of that is, you know, I think we're seeing consumer behavior really change. On the first side is that when we think about what's happening, when we look at Q2 2020 compared to Q2 2019, there's a significant increase in terms of really downloads from a games perspective. on iOS. New game downloads grew about 20% year over year to nearly 3 billion. And game downloads on Google Play really grew about 25% year over year, about 11 billion downloads in Q2 2020, accounting for nearly 8 of every game downloaded across the different app stores as well. So massive spike and massive continued increase in gaming as a whole. We have a lot of our customers in the gaming sector today. And so we continue to work very closely with each and every one of you in terms of continuing to drive really that innovation as well. And in a privacy-led world that we're in today, I had a chance to author a blog post about IDFA and some of the changes and challenges that we're seeing. So I think we're all fully aware that it's a world that's changing continuously, and the ecosystem is also changing. We'll talk more about that as well. From a gaming perspective, we really see a higher, you know, share of overall downloads on Google Play than on iOS, which is pretty standard, I think, continuing all throughout. We have a really great kind of a app market index for Q2 2020 that you can find on our website that goes through in detail, a little bit more information for all of the different folks that are here today. And then on Google Play, both India and Brazil were the largest markets in terms of game downloads, while India and Indonesia had the largest growth of absolute downloads really quarter over quarter as well. From a genre perspective, casual action and board games, you know, drove the most quarter over quarter download growth as well. Growth in the casual categories really led by Save the Girl, by AppLovin. Action categories really led by Free Fire, which is a battle royale game by C. And you know, the arcade genre also saw, you know, the most downloads on iOS, followed by action and simulation. And if you think about really growth in the simulation category, we see Fishdom Deep Dive, which is a really significant game there as well. And then obviously, you know, a lot of other places and kind of other typical players that we continue to see really top of charts. In terms of really what we're looking at, right, both app stores saw growth, strong growth from a consumer spending perspective, and Google Play continued to see significant growth as well. And games also, you know, accounted for the majority as consumers really spent dollars on mobile games consistently throughout 2020. I think as we all look for ways to engage and really stay connected during the time that we're in. And I think that's a big theme that we see is, you know, as people look to think about, hey, how do we connect differently? And what are the ways in which that we want to think about, especially while social distancing gaming is really, you know, continues to be a strong area, and specifically multiplayer mobile games as well. And you can see some of the components there. Core games with really deep multiplayer components, such as Honor of Kings, you know, and Roblox, again, has climbed a bunch of different spots that you can basically see there. So it's one of the things that I think that we've noticed is the ability to provide an expansive online space to interact and form deeper bonds with people and really with friends is really a key theme, I think, that we're seeing here as well. And overall, downloads are still driven by simple, intuitive, casual games. So lots to kind of digest here. When we think about monetization, and I want to kind of, you know, take a step back and think about what we're really seeing, is there's definitely a desire, you know, I think at a macro level for people to realize that, hey, there's obviously in-app purchases, there's subscription revenue, but mobile ads are here to stay in terms of how we're kind of thinking about, you know, driving revenue, what that looks like, and the effectiveness of all those components continue to evolve over time, especially as we see some of the changes that are there. But consumer behavior, especially here in the US, are really saying, hey, you know what, I prefer to see mobile ads than actually pay for in-app purchases, especially as a macro level. So when we kind of looked at the survey, we're continuing to see that as a trend, and we continue to see it as a trend in terms of monetization at a high level as well. So part of that is, I think when we talk to publishers and a lot of different, you know, companies that we work with, as they think about the different stages of game development, one of the core components that comes up is, hey, the first time that we actually are going to experiment and add in an ad SDK, what happens? And oftentimes the hypothesis is that we're going to see a significant loss in terms of engagement and really MAU. But we actually are seeing the opposite, which is as different publishers go on and they actually install that SDKs, you're seeing a growth in downloads and an MAU as well. And I think it's a combination of different factors. Obviously, you're kind of launching and a lot of other things are there, and you know, you're able to go start monetizing. But you know, it's not this drop off that I think a lot of people have had this kind of concern as you kind of get started here as well. So, you know, monetization is definitely there, and we continue to really see strong effects, especially look at kind of pre and post periods. And part of what makes publishers, I think, successful is there's obviously a lot of emphasis around sophistication and the right way to go and drive monetization strategies. And I think a part of it is that, you know, looking and testing across different ad networks globally based on really where you are is really resulting in customers, you know, engaging more and ultimately driving additional revenue from an audience perspective. So the ability to really test, think about coverage, search for really optimal pricing and understand different audience segments that, you know, maybe have been neglected or potentially not even initially targeted are all opportunities that exist in terms of really thinking hard about, hey, how do we go and drive overall sophistication, right? Both in terms of, you know, on the UA side around testing and then also even on the monetization side as well. In terms of, you know, mobile games as a whole, I think the most successful games out there in terms of global downloads in Q1 2020, both iOS and Google Play had really more than 20 SDKs installed across, you know, advertising, attribution and analytics as a whole. So some of the rankings are here for you to take a closer look at as well. So continuing on the theme of experimentation and continuing on the theme, I think really need to understand and unpack what it looks like, especially on the UA and on the monetization side, is really critical as there's just additional sophistication. So I think part of that, what we're seeing is that as this happens on the consumer side, there's just a lot of engagement that people are actually seeing. So there's a lot of, on average, people are spending about 9 hours online per day with, you know, 11 connected devices that are all owned and just receiving a myriad of different ad exposures. So, you know, as you think about that, what is the way in which you're going to be able to differentiate and drive engagement and really, you know, build a loyal base is really critical, as everyone is actively looking to say, hey, how do we get some of your mind share in the attention economy that we live in today? And so part of what we've seen is best-in-class companies are thinking very carefully about the way in which you engage, you acquire, and you monetize really gamers, because it's really changed, right? And it's not just enough to really look at kind of some revenue and some core components. It's really critical to think about agility, right? And so understanding, hey, what's happening in the overall ecosystem, being able to view that in a way that is not only accurate, but allows you to quickly drive insights and then be agile as a publisher to be able to say, hey, I'm going to work with a new partner in terms of my overall ecosystem, or even more so, make those recommendations from a gaming perspective to development to actually say, hey, we are going to actively look at a specific user pack or a new revenue stream from a different level and deprioritize some other game components that we want to think about, no matter what type of game that you're actually in. And so this is really driving a new type of revenue data relationship as various different best-in-class companies really think hard about managing the whole life cycle and really driving a high level of agility strategically. And so what that means is that we're definitely seeing companies that are still struggling with some core components. So there's a lot of organizations today that have built multiple different silos and looking at reporting and really pulling in relevant information from usage information to product information to advertising UA information to advertising monetization information in multiple areas. And it's really difficult to be able to pull those pieces together. So even just trying to understand what's happening and then all the manual errors that go along with just entering things into spreadsheets and then let alone getting all the data ready so that you can get it ready for analysis, analyzing it and spending a lot of time really kind of working on some of these things. So I think we spent some time with customers, and one of our customers said, you know, when they looked at spreadsheet errors, right, they were much more likelier to see a lot more errors when their data was in spreadsheets, no surprise, as opposed to really having a performant overall platform that's really there. And so companies that are stuck and kind of mired in this environment are really challenged, right? Because what's happening is that it's really a trade-off exercise as everyone looks to retool and innovate for the future. So instead of really thinking about, hey, how do we go and build world-class innovative products that are going to go and drive attention and engagement across our user base, you spend a lot of time saying, hey, what I need to build some connectors. I need to think hard about joining different connectors and different data schemas together in order to understand some types of analysis and some types of performance, whether it's on the revenue side or whether it's been on the usage side, and put those pieces together. Instead of growing in-app purchases, you're oftentimes spending time troubleshooting different APIs. Various different partners update their APIs and globally they change as well. And so whether there's an API outage or whether there's a troubleshooting kind of component, you have to spend, you know, a lot of time doing that versus growing really your revenue. Outside of that, also thinking hard about optimization. So instead of optimizing really revenue opportunities and experimenting and thinking about, you know, the right price floors to look at and how do you go and drive optimal CPMs in various countries, as well, or even thinking about the shift in the monetization mix between, you know, subscription revenue to in-app purchases and how you want to experiment with that. You spend a lot of time communicating internally and communicating externally to even just try to understand what's happening. Identifying anomalies versus really pulling all those pieces together. And there's just on and on and on of just a lot of different other areas that we're really seeing best-in-class companies think differently about in order to think hard about where should I allocate my resources and how do we build a really performant organization. And so part of that is we actually think that there's a new way to engage. And so we're very excited about AppAnnie Ascend, which really solves a lot of these critical challenges to help provide the foundation for you as a publisher to innovate and future-proof how you need to build and think about monetization and really game development for the long term. So the first component is really understanding the overall partner network. So what does that mean? And how do you think about really engaging holistically across your entire advertising ecosystem, across your product analytics, across your attribution and MMP partners as needed, and really being able to pull all those pieces together very accurately, having fresh, accurate data. So once you pull all that, being able to enrich and transform that data with ease, and then quickly identify what are those opportunities that exist in terms of either potential areas of optimization or even potential areas of missed revenue as well. So that's really what Ascend does, right? So we pull the data sets together from various different ad tech partners and various different parts that you want to kind of pull together in terms of the ecosystem, being able to aggregate that, then being able to obviously unify and normalize that, visualize that with our solution set, all fueled by data science, so that you really can work through any different scenario you have, and you have one place to really start understanding your overall performance. In long term, our vision is obviously to have a side-by-side view of both first-party data and market data, fueled by data science with these two components, you know, quarantined and fully compliant. Excuse me. We're also very excited, as I talked about some of our customers. Here's some of the quotes that we have. We also did a webinar with Jam City, with Josh as well. So I'd encourage you, if you haven't already taken a listen to that, that's available on our website. Great opportunity to kind of learn more and really hear what are some of the ways that Jam City is utilizing the overall AppAnnie solution. And finally, there's also an opportunity for a free trial of AppAnnie Ascend on our website. Here are just some examples to kind of identify some quick reporting trends and also to think hard about revenue opportunities. And we can, happy to spend some more time digging into that as well as needed. Just to share with you a little about some of the things that we're thinking about today. Thank you so much for your time. And this concludes really what we wanted to share with everybody for now.
Hey, Ron. Thanks very much for this insightful presentation, for the numbers you're sharing. This is so good. We have a few questions, if you mind, okay?
Yes, that'd be great. Thanks, Igor.
Yeah. So the first one is, how do you feel about first-party data, third-party data when it comes to monetization?
Yeah, it's a really good question, right? So I think on the first party data side, right? So it's really your own data. And really, you know, how are you executing engagement as a publisher, right? So, you know, all those opportunities that exist there, you know, I think you definitely want to drive into that. I think you have to understand your monetization mix. And you have to have a solution set that can really quickly identify that. So you're spending time thinking about ways to go drive revenue as opposed to understanding your performance. So I think that's the first piece on the first party data. The second piece is when we think about market data, especially with the evolution of IDFA, not only do we think you need to really have an aggregate, you know, an aggregation type solution, I think you also need to think about market data and looking at that in terms of drawing inferences and thinking very carefully about where you need to go as a publisher as well. So really being able to bring those two pieces together to make the right business decisions is, I think, a really mission critical thing going forward.
Thank you very much. And the next question is, what will be the impact of IDFA on monetization? I mean, like the changes we all expect soon.
Yeah, I think, and I wrote a blog post about this today, and it's on the AppAnnie website, so it's a very timely question. You know, I think we can all agree with the changes that Apple has articulated. User level really data is no longer going to be available for people to really drive into, right? So as an advertiser, as a publisher, really need to think hard about, okay, with IDFA moving away, what is the new set of principles you need to employ to think hard about how to engage? So the first thing is still going to be all about campaign level data. So with campaign level data, you know, you need to start thinking about a different type of tool set and a different type of really approach, whether it's, you know, different types of people that you need to think hard about putting together, different processes you need to look at, and fundamentally a different lens about thinking hard about performance and experimentation. So you can start thinking through campaign level data. And for us, we really think the answer is not only to go really, really wide, so you can really have an aggregation type solution to pull multiple data sources together to really understand performance, but also quickly to be able to look at campaign level data across multiple platforms. And so the importance of being able to look at market data in addition to your own data is really mission critical as well. So those are some of our thoughts on IDFA.
Thank you very much. And you've mentioned we can also go read your post in AppAnnie's blog, right?
Yes, that's right. It's posted earlier today.
So guys, if you want to learn more thoughts from Ron on this point, go check the post in the blog. Thank you very much, Ron. This was a great presentation. And goodbye and take care.
Thanks, everybody. Really appreciate the time. Bye-bye.